Well, today is Earth Day. It's an observance that was originated in 1970 by then Wisconsin Senator Gaylord Nelson, who wanted to raise public consciousness about air and water pollution. A lot of people look at that Earth Day as the start of the modern environmental movement. Well, since 1970, actually since before 1970, NASA has had any number of missions that have been up taking pictures of planet Earth. One particular accomplishment has been the literally millions of images that have been gathered by the men and women who have had the rare opportunity to be seeing the Earth from that unique point of view. Joining us on this Earth Day is one of those astronauts to talk about the point of view. Don Pettit is a veteran of almost more than a year on board the International Space Station, 161 days as a member of Expedition 6, 193 days as a member of Expeditions 30 and 31, plus another 16 days in space as a member of shuttle mission STS-126. Just a guess, Don, how many photographs of Earth did you take in a year up there?
Oh, gosh. As a crew on Expedition 30, we took about a half a million pictures, and that doesn't count 20,000 some pictures we took as a crew on STS-126. So in 16 days, we took over 20,000 pictures. And then I think we took about 50,000 pictures during Expedition 6 as a crew.
Did you have an interest in photography before you flew?
Oh, I've been interested in photography since about the sixth grade when I got my first Brownie camera that shot 120 film, and I spent all my allowance doing film work in a dark room so I could see these mysterious images up here when you ran this film through the chemistry.
We've heard you and many of your colleagues try to express what it is like to see Earth from that vantage point. I'm going to ask you to try it one more time. Describe the view of Earth that you get from floating above it.
Okay. Earth from space, you have the vantage point of seeing detail on the length scale of half a continent. So you could be over Central Australia and you could see both the East Coast and the West Coast at the same time. That's the length scale that you could see. You can't quite see that with the United States because that continent stretched out a little bit more. But certainly the metaphor of being able to see structure on the length scale of half a continent allows you to see things that you can't see with your feet on the ground, that you can't see from being in an airplane. And from that vantage point, you see different patterns, different structure that is not visible when you get closer.
What parts of it, when you try to take all that in, what are the parts of that view that attract your attention? Do you like to try to capture?
I like, personally, to use a wide-angle lens on cameras and do wide-angle photography simply because it takes advantage of being able to see Earth on the length scale of half a continent. You can use our telephoto lenses. We've got a number of them from 800 millimeters to 1200 millimeter telephoto lenses. And if you're really, really good, you can get pictures that are almost as good as what you can get off of Google Earth. And so from my perspective, I like to do the wide angle views because I think that has the most of what this particular viewpoint has to offer.
Well, I asked you to share with us a couple of your favorite shots so that we could share them with everybody else and take a look at what they are. The first of these, if I could get you to describe what it is we're seeing. I see a coastline and maybe a volcano.
Okay, this is in Guatemala. And this is taken with infrared photography, near-infrared photography. And we have not been able to do this since around 2002, 2003, after Columbia. We quit flying film, and we lost our ability to do color-infrared photography because at that time it was all done with color-infrared film. And now we have modified digital cameras that give us back the color-infrared capability in digital form. So this is an infrared picture where plant material is bright red, and you can see there's jungles there and there are volcanoes poking up. And this is a little different than satellite infrared photography in that it's oblique. You're looking off axis, and human beings on station could take pictures of objects and at angles that a pre-programmed satellite typically is outside the its event horizon for programming.
Let me move on to one other, which is is clouds in of some kind of way, but framed by black on both sides.
Okay, this is an image of polar mesospheric clouds, or also known as noctilucent clouds. And these are clouds that are right on the fringes of space. They're around 82 to 84 kilometers in altitude, and space is defined about at 100 kilometer altitude. So they're right on the fringes of space, and primarily seen in polar regions during the summertime. And they're elusive, they're the will-o'-the-wisp, and we're trying to understand more about these clouds, and space is a great place to observe these.
And in this other, in this next image, we see a portion of the station from where you do that.
Yes, this is a picture of what I like to call the view of my view.
Uh-huh.
And it highlights the cupola, which is this wonderful module filled with windows, seven windows looking nadir at Earth. And you can open up the shutters and you could do marvelous photography of daytime Earth and nighttime Earth in the transition, the day-night terminator regions.
Now, on your last trip, you also figured out a way to take images that have come to be called star trails images. And we're going to show a couple of them while you talk, because I want to know what was your inspiration for doing this, and maybe more importantly, how did you accomplish what we're about to see here?
Well, star trail pictures is something that amateur astronomers do. You put a camera on a tripod, you point it up at the sky, and you open the shutter, and as Earth turns, it makes the stars into streaks. And you could do this on space station, and your orbital motion will make the not only the stars streaks, but the cities down below will also be streaking. And if there are thunderstorms, they are flashing off like flashbulbs in a dark room. I first started doing this during Expedition 6 back in 2002 with film, because the digital cameras back then wouldn't allow a long enough exposure without getting a right air to disc, and you don't like that when you're taking a picture. But film would allow us to take these star trail pictures, and then I continued that on STS-126, and then I really had the time to zero in on this during Expedition 30-31.
Those are some remarkable images. They're really, really quite special. From the time you first flew on Expedition 6 till the time you came home from Expedition 31 is about 10 years in between. From your own, just your own personal view, can you see a difference in the Earth over that 10-year hunk of time?
The basic Earth looks the same, and Earth is happy to go on with or without us as human beings. And I think it's important for us to realize this and make sure that Earth goes on with us as riders. One of the more obvious effects over the last 10 years has been the display of cities at night, how we sprinkle as human beings the lights from our cities. And there's this amazing display of lights that are dictated by geography, by a cultural choice of lighting, and by the technology used. And just as an example, if you're next to a coastline, you'll see all these lights, and then it gets dark really quick right at the coastline. Some cultures use mercury vapor lighting, and their cities have this blue-green cast from the mercury vapor. Others use sodium vapor lighting, and you can see that. Some cities, the older parts of town, are blue-green, and the newer boroughs are the yellow-orange. And so you could see the extent of technology, you could see the extent of geography, and you could see the extent of cultural choice. Some kinds of lighting produce less light pollution, and you could see the countries that don't have any light pollution technology, and their cities are lit up in a different way than cities where they follow a light pollution doctrine.
It's fascinating, and on behalf of everybody who hasn't had the opportunity to see what you've seen, thanks for telling us about it. Thanks for sharing some of these great pictures.
It's my pleasure. Recording what we see as astronauts from space of Earth is one way of sharing this experience to folks on Earth that don't get a chance to get into space.
Another way of sharing it is that there are astronaut photographs of Earth that are posted on a special website at earthobservatory.nasa.gov. And for Earth Day, at this special URL right down here, you can see images of the day, maps, and features that will excite the geography enthusiast. There are tens and tens of thousands of photographs that you can see. Special for Earth Day right here, every day at earthobservatory.nasa.gov.